want to introduce you this morning to the team that's going to be prosecuting this case. First of all, we have lead prosecutor, Chief Deputy District Attorney Karen Pearson. Senior Deputy District Attorney Richard Orman. We have Senior Deputy District Attorney Jacob Edson. We have Deputy District Attorney Andrew Steers. Working with us on investigation are Aurora Police Detectives Gretchen Cronapple, Craig Apple, and Chuck Mell. So as you know, the rules in the state of Colorado limit the amount of information that prosecutors can provide to the press. So the judge ordered us this morning to follow Rule 3.6 and Rule 3.8. And when that order is issued by the court, we are going to give you a copy of that so that you can see what kinds of things we can talk about and what kinds of things we cannot talk about. At this point, everyone is interested in a fair trial with a just outcome for everybody involved that stands the test of the appellate process, and we are very concerned about that on behalf of the victims, as well as the defenses on behalf of the defendants. So that is our focus at this point in time, to make sure that we are able to provide information to, we have hundreds of victims, as you may guess, in this case. And one of the ways we want to provide them information is through the media as much as we can. Some of them went back to Ohio or are going back to Ohio today, or other parts of the country and even other parts of the world. So we want to make sure that we can provide them information in a variety of ways, including through the press, if that's acceptable. You saw what happened today in court. There was what's called a Rule 5 advisement, where the judge basically told the defendant what constitutional rights he can expect to have in this case. You heard the judge say that there was a probable cause determination. In Colorado, we do an initial probable cause determination to make sure that there's kind of an overview of the evidence, so that the court knows that there's enough evidence to continue to hold the defendant. The defendant is being held without bond at this point in time. Eventually, there will be a preliminary hearing and a proof evident presumption great hearing, and we will ask the court to continue holding him without bond. So, are there any questions?
I was in the courtroom. I'm Derek Peterson from CBS. I was part of the media that was actually in the courtroom, and I was struck by the fact that the defendant seemed to have no emotion, did not follow what was going on. I don't think I ever saw his head turn when conversations were being made. Like, is he on a medication or something, or is he aware? Can you tell us, is there something that would affect his demeanor, because he seemed to not even pay attention?
We would have no information about that. That is not something that would be shared with us.
As the district attorney here and a longtime prosecutor, from the outset, does this seem as though it is a slam dunk case, given the evidence you've amassed so far?
I would say there's no such thing as a slam dunk case. It is a case where we're still looking at the enormous amount of evidence, and we would never presume that it would be slam dunk. We will work very hard on this case to prosecute it just like we would any other case.
Gerald, can you talk about what he's being held on, please? What he was arrested on, please? Can you tell us?
Carol, I'm aware that you may not be in office when the decision's made, but if it was your decision, would this be a death penalty case?
I don't think that that's a case that can be made in the abstract. There's so much that victims have to take into account, and victims will be impacted by that decision in an enormous way for years if the death penalty is sought. That's a very long process that impacts their lives for years. And so they will want to have, and we will want to get their input before we make any kind of a decision on that.
Ms. Chambers, can you please tell us, he was arraigned first appearance today on the charges that he was arrested on. What is that charge or charges, please?
Well, he was not arraigned today. This was simply the first appearance, and the arraignment comes much further down the line. The charges on which the court found probable cause included first-degree murder.
Could federal law be applied to this case? Could there ultimately also be a federal trial?
Theoretically, that there are ways that could happen, but that's very speculative.
Ms. Chambers, do you anticipate an insanity defense?
I don't know that we're anticipating anything right now. I think we have to really look more at what information we're being given and sort it all out and then make some decisions.
Carol, what about psychic
eval? Being taken to protect his safety in jail.
That's my understanding, that he is being held in isolation. It was my first time seeing him, and it is important that we treat him as we would treat any other defendant coming into the criminal justice system.
And Carol, at what point, I know that you said you want to talk to the victims before you just determine whether or not to seek the death penalty, but can you give us an idea of like where in the process that comes and what we should be looking for?
It comes, the death penalty decision has to be made within 60 days of the arraignment.
Okay.
So it is months down the line still. But we will, over the course of those months, be talking with all of the victims, developing relationships just so that they know who we are and who they can talk to, and that will take some time in this case.
How are you managing
the number of high-profile cases in this county?
We are managing this, all these victims, with as many victim advocates as we can get. We are using victim advocates from other offices. We're using PIOs from different offices, just so each family has somebody else that they can rely on if they need to. But we also have a place on our website. Our website is da18.org, and people can go to that website and let us know what their email address is, and we can send out mass email alerts to this group of victims if they want to do that.
When is he going to be able to have a psychic eval?
There are high profile cases in this district. Can you tell us where this one ranks for you and your staff?
I don't know if we rank cases. They are all important to us, and we want to give each and every victim the attention, and each and every case the attention and resources that it needs.
How many charges do you expect to file?
I think that's unknown at this point in time. There's the potential for many, but we haven't made those decisions.
If the West End is one of them, would that be considered?
We don't know that yet.
How long of a lifespan do you see this case having?
That is so unpredictable. I would have no idea. That would not be something that we would normally consider in state prosecution.
If you talk to the victims and the mood is not to go for the death penalty, do you have discretion? Does the team have discretion to go against that? Or are you bound in some way to follow their wishes?
It will ultimately be the decision of the prosecutors on the case.
Well, what's Holmes been like, in talking to prosecutors, has he been forthcoming, has he been not cooperative? What's his demeanor been like?
That's nothing. We don't have a lot of information on that, and nothing we could speak to if we did. Does anybody else on the team have anything they want to say? That is also very unpredictable. It's going to depend on the number of motions, the availability of the court. Nothing in the court system moves all that quickly, and so we couldn't predict. At least a year, I would say.
Carol, what sort of information are you still trying to figure out? Obviously, you learned quite a lot in the first couple days. Where from now, what are the questions that you still have that you're trying to get answers to?
It's still a very active ongoing investigation. We're still doing subpoenas, search warrants, and so we're still looking at this case from every angle, following up on information that the media has obtained that would be of interest to the officer. So we're still very much partnered with the Aurora Police Department on finding information.
Considering the amount of media, would you anticipate a change of venue request because of all that's unfolded here?
We certainly know that that will be an issue that will be brought up to the court.
In terms of what we saw today, is that the standard color that a suspect may bear?
I would refer that to the Sheriff's Department. I don't know how they address it.
I understand Colorado is a little unique in the way murder charges can be filed, where there were 12 deaths here, but they could be 24 charges. Can
Yes.
you explain that to me?
There are different ways that someone can commit first-degree murder. One of those ways, for example, is after deliberation, but if another way is extreme indifference. And they just are two different ways. And so somebody can, based on the conduct involved, can commit both of those offenses.
The suspect's family has said they are cooperating with the investigation.
I have no information about that.
Is there a deadline for when you can file charges, and when do you expect to file them?
There's no specific deadline in the rules of when we can file charges. In this jurisdiction, it's traditionally after 72 hours, but there can be special circumstances when we ask for longer, and this is clearly one of those cases. So the filing of charges is set for next Monday morning.
When's the next hearing?
Next Monday morning
at
8:30? 9:30.
Will the defendant be there for that?
That would have to be directed at the defense attorney.
What is the next hearing?
No, the next hearing is filing of charges, and that's where we give the defendant, or we give the defense attorneys, the actual charges that the defendant will be facing.
Considering a possible change of venue, do you believe it's the victim's rights to have this trial here because of everything unfolding here?
I don't think it's the victim's right. Certainly, I'm sure it's their preference to have it close to their home and where it's most convenient for them. But all considerations will be weighed by the court.
Because there will be so many charges, how long do you think you will be amending them, adding, removing, that sort of thing?
Well, we're trying to get it right the first time, but as we will be continuing to get more information, in a case like this, the investigation doesn't stop. It will continue up to trial. And so as we find more information, we want to make sure we've got the right charges. So I couldn't predict that, but it's certainly something we're willing to do if necessary. So maybe one more question?
Can I ask a non-legal question, please? I know that we've been in court, we've watched the proceedings, but considering the nature of what has unfolded and how it has hurt this community, what is the mood of your team about this case?
Our team is, it's just a difficult type of case to be involved in.
Right.
And I think everybody is, just has been working, just like the police. They've been working all weekend to get done what needs to get done. I'm not sure they've stopped to consider how it's impacting them yet at this point. I think we want to get everything we can as quickly as we can. If there's anybody out there who knows anything about this who hasn't talked to police yet, please contact the Aurora Police Department or contact us, and we'll get you in touch with the right people. Thank you.